Hi, in today's video I'm going to be showing you how I'm making my hamster food mix. But I've said it before and I'll say it again, I'm not a vet or animal nutritionist or anything like that. I've just done a bit of research and I've educated myself through resources that I've found on the internet. If you're looking to make your own hamster food mix, I do encourage you to look at a few more sources because there are a lot of different ways to approach hamster nutrition, and what might work for me and my hamster might not work for you and yours. I just want to start off by saying that whilst I'm making my own hamster food mix today, I do think that it would be dangerous to feed a hamster on this alone, so along with the mix that I make, 50% of what I will be feeding my hamster will be commercial, and by this I mean the pellets or lab blocks that you can buy for your hamster in a shop. This is because no matter how good or nutritious the mix that we make at home is, we can't provide things like the fermentation products of certain bacteria that help with gut health, and as well, we're not able to add all of the various vitamins and minerals that a hamster needs. The pellets that I use are a mix of Science Selective and the Pets at Home hamster nuggets, but if you're in the US, I'd strongly recommend looking at the Missouri Mouse and Rat blocks. So you might be thinking, if pellets are formulated in a way that is good for hamsters, what is the point of making a seed mix? One of the main reasons is to add variety. Hamsters only have a short time on Earth, so why not try and make that time as interesting and enjoyable as possible with food that is tasty and good for them? And as well as making your own mix, you can increase the quality, so you can get rid of foods that have sugars, dyes and preservatives in them, and you can choose to spend money on ingredients that aren't just there to bulk up the bag. It's widely agreed that the ideal hamster food should have a protein level of 17-19%, a fat level of 4-7%, a fibre level of 6-15%, a large number of whole unprocessed ingredients in addition to pellets, probiotics and prebiotics, a really low amount of filler ingredients, no added sugars, artificial dyes, BHA, BHT and ethoxyquin. In the actual mix, it helps to divide the food into four main groups: seeds, legumes, dehydrated vegetables, and animal protein. Proportions of each food group will always vary from mix to mix because everyone will be using different ingredients, and obviously you want to hit the ideal protein, fat, and fiber percentages. But I started out by trying to aim for around 40% seeds, 30% vegetables, 20% legumes, and 10% animal protein. Well, the next natural question is, how many different ingredients should there be in your mix? I've seen people say that around 20 to 30 different ingredients is a good aim. I tried to start off with 20 ingredients for my mix, however, Mabel and I had creative differences because before I made the mix, I tested how she'd respond to the foods that she'd never had before, and she absolutely refused to even touch three of the ingredients. So for my actual mix, I've got 17. And while this isn't at 20, it's a lot more than you'll find in commercial seed mixes anyway, so I'm quite happy with that. To plan your own homemade mix, you want to open up an Excel spreadsheet. For this example, I'm going to be using 20 ingredients, and I've listed them all down here with their respective protein, fat, and fiber percentages. To find these percentages, you will need to do some research. Hopefully, you'll be able to buy bags of ingredients that have the nutritional information already on, but I found for a lot of seeds and grains, this doesn't tend to be the case, so that's when we have to turn to the internet. I like to use USDA and nutrition data, then I'll search for and cross-reference with other credible sources from Google, but this as well is a huge indicator as to why you shouldn't feed your hamster your homemade mix alone, as you can't possibly find out the exact nutritional information unless you also happen to be a scientist and have access to a lab. But anyway, because the value I found was already for 100 grams worth of oats, I don't really need to do anything to convert the grams for the protein, fibre and fat levels to percentages. But say, if you find the nutritional info for squash and it shows you the information for 250 grams, you want to find the protein as a percentage of that. So you'll do this number here over 250, then multiplied by 100, and then you'll get the percentage of protein. Once you've got the nutrition percentages for each of the ingredients, then you can decide the percentage of the mix that the ingredient will make up. So in this example, because I've got 20 ingredients, I'm just putting everything at 5% because, as you can see here, this makes up 100%. Then you've got to do a little bit of maths and calculate the value of protein, fat and fibre that each of the ingredients will contribute to the mix at the chosen percentage levels. So, for example, oat groats are 17% protein, and at the moment they'll make up 5% of the mix. So I'm putting a formula in to times 17 by the chosen percentage, and that equals 0.85%. But if there's a higher proportion of oat groats in the mix, like 10%, the contributed level of protein will go up. Then you want to do this exact same thing for the fat and fibre levels too. So now I'm just going to go ahead and do the same thing for the other ingredients. Now once I've got the contributed level numbers, in these cells over here, I'm adding all of the ones with protein together, and all of the ones for fat, and then all of the ones for fibre too. So as you can see here, the protein and fibre levels for this mix are within the recommended ranges, but the fat level is way over. So this is where you can start playing around with the proportions of the ingredients in the mix, but you always have to make sure that when they're added up, it equals 100%. So even though I've managed to get the levels within the recommended ranges, it's still the best idea to try and come up with your own recipe and not just use this one, because one, you might not be able to get a hold of all of the ingredients. Two, your hamster might be like mine and refuse to eat some of the foods. And three, your hamster might have different requirements, so they might do better on less fat, they might need higher fiber, or because of their age, they might need more or less protein. There are just loads of things that you have to take into consideration, so please, please do your research. Anyway, moving on, once I'd finished planning, I was able to buy my ingredients. But here is where I want to give you a little warning about weevils. Grain weevils are tiny little black beetles that burrow into seeds and reproduce in them, and they can lay 30 to 200 eggs at a time. I had a sealed shop-bought packet of food which I'd emptied into another container, and one day the whole thing was crawling with them. Like, it's given me flashbacks just thinking about it. But I had no idea what they were, because I feel like not that many people talk about them online. But since looking them up, I've seen that people have actually bought bags of seeds from a place like Whole Foods and had this happen to them. So what you're going to do when you buy the seeds, grains or hamster mix from now on is freeze it straight away. Keep the bags in the freezer for 3 to 4 days, thaw them for another 3 to 4 days, and then freeze and thaw again. Moving on to something a little bit more fun and exciting, dehydrating your vegetables. So you can buy these already dehydrated, you can be a professional and use a dehydrator, but I'm using an oven. So I'm cutting my vegetables into small pieces, so once they're dehydrated they can go straight into my mix. Once these have all been chopped up, I laid them in rainbow water on some parchment paper on some baking trays. Then I'm putting those into my fan oven at around 90 degrees centigrade for around 6 hours. I checked them and rotated the pieces every 2 hours, and you'll be able to tell when they're done when they're no longer soft or sticky at all. Right, now I'm actually getting into making my mix. I just want to remind you that if you make your own, remember that the proportions of each ingredient need to actually be weighed out rather than measured in cups or tablespoons, because the nutritional information you've gathered will be based on grams. If you start to use volumetric measurements, it can mess up the whole thing, since foods all have different densities. So for example, if 5% of your mix is oats and there's also 5% of dried zucchini, a tablespoon of each will not be the same thing. But 15 grams of each will be, if you get what I mean. When I said in my last video that making your own mix is kind of complicated, do you see where I'm coming from now? But anyway, let's just enjoy this montage of ingredient pouring.
Missing someone, but with all your arms.
now I've mixed my homemade mix together, I can mix this with my pellets, and like I said earlier, I'm using a 50-50 split between pellets and my homemade seed mix. Using the method I showed in my last video, I've already made sure that mixing my mix and the pellets together in these proportions would result in an overall mix that's still within the recommended ranges of protein, fat and fibre, and it's so important that you do this as well. And then I'm just going to go ahead and feed Mabel by scattering these around her cage so then she can go ahead and find them on her own. Thank you so much for watching. Please like, comment, and subscribe for more.